my name is Marguerite Millet, and welcome to all my friends at the Fountains. These are very strange and uncertain times. I hope you're all well. Since none of us are really going to be going anywhere very soon, I have been invited to present my lectures to you via technology. So we'll see how this is going to work out. I want to express gratitude to my husband, Jim, for helping me with these videos and setting things up. We'll be offering these lectures weekly instead of monthly, so if you have any particular artist or time period or any topic you would like me to cover, please let the staff know, and I will plan for it. I'm not going anywhere. Today, we're going to be listening to Judy Garland, considered by many to be one of the greatest artists of the 20th century. She had a career that lasted 45 years, and she attained international stardom. She was an actress, a recording artist, and a performer on the concert stage. She won many, many awards. She was just so versatile. She had an Academy Juvenile Award, Golden Globe Award, Special Tony Award, and Grammy Award for Album of the Year. And she was the first woman to win in that category. What I wanted to do is start off with an up song. Most of us are feeling kind of down from what has been going on, so I think we should be focusing on the joy of life, everything that is still to be found. So we are going to be listening to Lucky Day.
Oh boy, I'm lucky. I'll say I'm lucky. This is my lucky day.
And it was written for The Birth of the Blues. And in the 1940s, it was used as a theme song for NBC for Your Hit Parade, the radio program It was sponsored by Lucky Strike Cigarettes. You see that? Lucky Strike Cigarettes, lucky day. You see how they did that? Okay. So now let's go to Judy's biography. She was born in 1922. Her name was Frances Gum, and born in Grand Rapids, Minnesota. She was the youngest child of vaudevillians, and they settled in Grand Rapids, and they bought a movie theater that featured vaudeville acts. And Garland went right on with the family business. She was 2½ when she made her first appearance on stage with her two older sisters singing Jingle Bells. The Gum sisters performed there for the next few years, and their mother would accompany them on the piano. The family relocated to California in 1926, so at that point Judy was, or Frances, was 4 years old. Their father bought another theater, and their mother began managing their daughters and working to get them into motion pictures. The Gum sisters toured the vaudeville circuit for many years, and in 1934, they performed in Chicago with George Jessel, and he encouraged them to change their names. He didn't think the Gum sisters sounded all that great. They changed it to the Garland sisters because it was said that he told them they were as pretty as a garland of flowers. Frances then changed her name to Judy. She was inspired by a popular Hoagie Carmichael song. Anyway, the group eventually did break up when Suzanne Garland flew to Reno, Nevada, and married a musician. But before they ended up breaking up, MGM sent a scout over to one of their performances in Los Angeles and to report back. A few days later, Judy and her father were brought in for an audition, and the studio immediately signed Garland to a contract with MGM. However, the studio didn't really know what to do with her because she was only 13 years old. So she was too young for the adult roles, but at 13 she was also too old for child roles. One director who worked with her wrote, "Judy went to school at MGM with Ava Gardner, Lana Turner, Elizabeth Taylor. Judy was the big money maker at the time, a big success. But she was the ugly duckling. I think it had a very damaging effect on her emotionally for a long time. I think it lasted forever, really. Her insecurity really wasn't helped by the fact that one of the studio chiefs would call her his little hunchback. They even had her wear removable caps on her teeth and rubberized discs to reshape her nose. Her big break came along when she sang a special arrangement of You Made Me Love You, I Didn't Want to Do It, to Clark Gable at a birthday party that the studio had arranged. Her rendition was so well received that she performed the song in the All-Star Extravaganza Broadway Melody of 1938, and she sang it to a photograph of him. We'll hear more about that later. MGM hit upon a really winning formula. It paired Garland with Mickey Rooney in a string of what were known as backyard musicals. They first appeared together in 1937, and then they were contracted to make a film every year, along with all their other filming commitments. In fact, of this time period, Garland wrote that she, Rooney, and other performers, younger performers, were constantly prescribed amphetamines in order to stay awake and keep up with the frantic, crazy pace of making one film after another. They were also given then barbiturates to take so they could get to sleep. The regular use of drugs, she said, led to an addiction and a lifelong struggle. And she later did resent the hectic schedule and believed that MGM stole her youth. So, while all this is going on, she was cast as Dorothy Gale in The Wizard of Oz in 1938. This role changed everything. The Wizard of Oz was a tremendous critical success. At the 1939 Academy Awards ceremony, Garland received her only Academy Award. It was a special Academy Juvenile Award for her performances, two performances, in 1939, including The Wizard of Oz and Babes in Arms with Mickey Rooney. And she went on to star in a long list of movies after that, all musicals. And one thing I wanted to play for you now, she had a tremendous hit with this, It's a Great Day for the Irish. Irish-American song written in 1940 for the film version of the George M. Cohan Broadway show, Little Nellie Kelly. The rights had been sold to MGM as a starring vehicle for Judy Garland. Now, it was partly written to capitalize on Garland's Irish roots. Garland was a quarter Irish. And it was to be used in a recreation of New York's famous St. Patrick's Day parade going up Fifth Avenue. Garland would be singing this song and dancing up the avenue with her father, grandfather, and her boyfriend. The movie was pretty well received, but it's really only remembered now for this song that introduced into Irish-American culture Judy Garland. Also, it was her only death scene that she ever filmed. This version we'll listen to is part of the London sessions for Capitol Records in 1960. She often sang it live, particularly in concerts in Ireland and the UK, where audiences clapped along and danced in the aisles. One review of the show wrote, "She shook the walls with her raucous rendition." Now, this lively song also includes a special verse of very difficult, tongue-twisting, rhyming Irish surnames. And, of course, Garland sang it effortlessly. The song went on to be a worldwide St. Patrick's Day anthem. So here is It's a Great Day for the Irish. Romance with bandleader Artie Shaw. She was very devoted to him and was heartbroken when he decided to run off with Lana Turner and eloped with her. Garland then began a relationship with musician David Rose, and on her 18th birthday he gave her an engagement ring. The studio, however, intervened because at the time he was still married to actress and singer Martha Raye. So they agreed to wait a year to allow for his divorce to become final. Garland and Rose were married in July 1941. The media called it a true rarity. Not sure what that means. The couple divorced in 1944. One of Garland's most successful films for MGM was Meet Me in St. Louis, 1944, and she was only 21. This was one of the first films in her career that gave her the opportunity to be the attractive leading lady. Now, I'm mentioning this, two important things occurred at that time. First of all, Vincent Minnelli was assigned to direct. And the second thing was that he asked a certain makeup artist, Dorothy Ponnadel, to be assigned to Garland. And Garland was surprised when Ponnadel told her, actually, you're a very pretty girl. You don't need the caps. You don't need the disc on your nose. You're pretty just the way you are. So Ponnadel became the go-to makeup artist for Judy Garland in every movie she made after that with MGM. And the other thing was during the filming, Garland and Minnelli had a relationship and they married in 1945. In 1946, daughter Liza was born. In 1947, Garland suffered a nervous breakdown, was placed in a private sanitarium. But then, after this, she co-starred for the first and only time with Fred Astaire. Fred Astaire had replaced Gene Kelly. Kelly had just broken his ankle. Anyway, she starred with Fred Astaire in Easter Parade, 1948, which became her top-grossing film at MGM. MGM was thrilled by the huge box office receipts, and Garland was immediately teamed again with Astaire in The Barclays of Broadway. Unfortunately, during this time, she developed a real problem with pills and alcohol, missed days of work. So MGM suspended her, and she was replaced in the film by Ginger Rogers. So that's how Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers began their working relationship. In the fall of 1948, she returned to MGM to replace a pregnant June Allison for the musical film In the Good Old Summertime, co-starring Van Johnson. In this, her daughter Liza made her film debut at age 2.5 at the end of the film. Enormously successful at the box office. We're going to listen to a song now, Chicago, which originally had been written in 1922, recorded by many artists. But this song was heard behind the titles of the film In the Good Old Summertime. It's this arrangement that was finally released years later in 1961, and we're going to hear that now. So here is Chicago.
I got the surprise of my life. I had to stop and stare. I saw a man dancing with his own wife. And you will never guess where. Chicago, Chicago, that toddling town, the toddling town. Chicago, Chicago, I'll show you around. I love it, that's your bottom dollar, you lose the blues in Chicago, Chicago, the town that Philly Sunday could not shut down. On State Street, that great street, I just want to stay, I just want to stay. They do things they don't do on Broadway. Say, they have the time of their life. Think of the man who danced with his wife in Chicago. 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 Free and easy town, grassy, breezy town. Chicago. Chicago. Let me cool my heels while I down the partial field. Come and walk with me along the lake to the Drake. Holler and whoop all through the loop. Shout how now to Mrs. O'Leary's cow. No, she, life is peachy. Chicago, we'll meet at the pub room, Ambassador East, to say the least on shish kebab and breast of squab. We will feast and dance. Don't tell
now going to listen to a medley of some of Garland's most well-known songs from this time period when she was making these musicals. And these are three songs that are most identified with Judy, except for Over the Rainbow. We'll be listening to Over the Rainbow later. So we're going to hear You Made Me Love You, I Didn't Want to Do It, the song that she sang to Clark Gable, and then sang to his picture later on in the movies. For Me and My Gal, which was in the 1942 film For Me and My Gal, Judy and Gene Kelly performed it together, and that version was a major hit. And then the last one is The Trolley Song, which was made famous in the 1944 film Meet Me in St. Louis, and it was nominated for the Academy Award for Best Original Song. So here now is Judy Garland's medley.
Congregating for me and my gal. the parson's waiting for me and my gal. And someday we're gonna build a little home for two or three or four or more in Loveland for me and my gal. Clang, clang, clang went the trolley. Ding, ding, ding went the bell. Sing when my heartstrings, from the moment I saw him I fell. Chuck, chuck, chuck went the motor. Bump, bump, bump went the brake. Thump, thump, thump went my heartstrings. When he smiled you could feel the car shake. He tipped his hat and took a seat. He said he hoped he hadn't stepped on my feet. He asked my name, I held my breath. I couldn't speak because he scared me half to death. Buzz, buzz, buzz went the buzzer. Wop, wop, wop went the wheels. Stop, stop went my heartstrings. As he started to leave, I took hold of his sleeve with my hand.
Divorced Minnelli in 1951. 1952, she married Sidney Luft, her tour manager and producer. Garland gave birth to Lorna Luft, who herself became an actress and a singer. She gave birth to her in 1952, and then Joey Luft in 1955. Garland appeared with James Mason in the Warner Brothers film A Star Is Born in 1954. That was the first remake of the 1937 film and was intended as a vehicle for Garland. She and her husband at the time, Sidney Luft, produced the film through their production company. The film received critical and popular acclaim, and we're going to listen to a few songs from the film now. The first one is Swanee, which seems a little odd, right? It's an American popular song. It was written in 1919 by George Gershwin, lyrics by Irving Caesar. Most often associated with the singer Al Jolson, who had put it in his show with very great success in 1920. And actually, it provided the vehicle for Gershwin to begin earning amazing amounts of money and then being able just to be writing for theater and films instead of having to write pop songs. But it's ironic that he never wrote a number equaling to the sales of Swanee. So this song was featured by Judy Garland in A Star Is Born. So here is Swanee.
Give the world to be among the folks in the IX. I even know my family's waiting for me, praying for me down by the Swanee. The folks up north will see me no more when I get to that Swanee shore. Yeah.
we're going to hear from A Star Is Born is The Man That Got Away. And this is a real torch song, written by Harold Arlen, lyrics by Ira Gershwin. And 1955, it was nominated for the Academy Award for Best Original Song. It was written in response to the screenwriter's request for a dive song. So in the movie scene, it's kind of after hours at a club. The chairs are put up on the tables, and there's cigarette smoke, very atmospheric. And the piano player asks Garland just to take it from the top. So there's no audience there. She's just singing this song on her own. And very, probably the most important single musical sequence in the entire movie. And she later then used this song in most of her concert acts. She really kept it up. It was great. So here is The Man That Got Away.
Their glitter, the winds grow colder, suddenly you're older, and all because of the man that got away. No
think that's one of my favorite songs. I just love that. You can really hear the versatility in her voice. Just fantastic. So also what was happening in the early 1950s, she was doing some concert tours. One very notable one was 4 months in Europe. Big success, sold out. And this particular tour centered on the songs of Al Jolson and the revival of the vaudeville tradition. It was so successful that she performed the show at New York's Palace Theater. And that engagement broke all records for the theater. And Garland was actually awarded with a special Tony Award for her contribution to the revival of vaudeville. So we're going to hear a medley of songs that are actually called Judy at the Palace. And it's associated with the acts who actually performed in the past at the Broadway Palace Theater during vaudeville. So this was put together specifically for her 19-week palace run. We're going to hear Shine On Harvest Moon. That was performed at the Palace in the 30s by Ada Jones and Billy Murray, in the 40s by Ethel Waters and Kate Smith. Some of These Days was sung by Sophie Tucker, and My Man became Fanny Bryce's best-known song. I Don't Care was written in 1905, sung by Eva Tangway, and sung by Judy in the Good Old Summertime. By the way, you're going to hear in the introduction, she mentions Al Jolson, but actually he never played at the Palace. So here is the medley, Judy at the Palace.
Sky. he takes me in his arms. The world is right, all right. I don't care what people think of me. I'm happy-go-lucky, they say that I'm plucky, contented and carefree. I stand in front of you. I'm proud to play the palace. It's like a dream come true. That is why I'd like to shout it up and down, just to tell Broadway that the two-a-day
Okay, so then to wrap up a bit before we get to Over the Rainbow. 1963, Garland sued Luft for divorce. Continued to perform on stage, do guest appearances on TV. She married her tour promoter, Mark Herron, in 1965. That didn't work out. They divorced 6 months later. And once that was finalized, she married nightclub manager Mickey Deans in London. And sadly, in 1969, Deans found Garland dead in the bathroom of their rented house in London. She was only 47 years old. The coroner stated that the cause of death was, quote, an incautious self-overdosage, unquote, of barbiturates. In her last will, Garland made many, many generous bequests, but they couldn't be fulfilled because there were so many debts on the estate. In fact, her daughter, Liza Minnelli, worked to pay off her mother's debts, and but the other person who helped out was family friend Frank Sinatra. Opera singer Maria Callas once said that Garland possessed the most superb voice she had ever heard. Bing Crosby said that no other singer could be compared to her. And it's true, her voice is capable of connecting to that vulnerable part in ourselves like no other singer. So we're going to end now with Over the Rainbow, and it really doesn't need much of an introduction. It was written for the film Wizard of Oz, sung by Garland in her starring role as Dorothy Gale. It won the Academy Award for Best Original Song, and it became Garland's signature song. Interestingly, the song was deleted from the film during the preview because the MGM chief executive and the producer thought it slowed down the picture, and it sounded like something for Jeanette McDonald and not for a little girl singing in a barnyard. But one of the associate producers and Garland's vocal coach pressed them, and they did include it. She performed it for 30 years, singing it just as she had for the film. She said she wanted to remain true to the character of Dorothy and to the message of longing to be somewhere over the rainbow.
Somewhere over the rainbow, that I heard of once in a lullaby somewhere.
Stay well, and I will see you next week. Thank you.